morning. It's 9:02 in Barbados and across the Eastern Caribbean on this Friday, September 6th, 2024. This is Let's Talk About It on Q100.7 FM. I'm Rashid Best, joined by my co-host Joshua Hinkson, and we are joined by Alwin Adams, who is here once again to serenade us on issues of education. Mr. Adams, good morning.
Good morning, sir, and good morning to Barbados. I'm very pleased to be here once again, and I hope that we will have a very productive and fruitful session, and that persons will be able to enlighten me, and that they should be able to get some information that would be useful to them coming out of the program.
Now,
good morning once again.
Yes, and Mr. Adams, we invite our the listening public to call us at 434-1007 or 434-1070. You can also send your WhatsApp contributions to 434-1007. Now, a topical issue relating to education is the whole push by the government to reform the system in a comprehensive way. What is the history behind education reform in Barbados, Mr. Adams?
Well, in a way, it is felt by, you know, by a sector of the population, is that it is kind of a brain wave that has come up by the authorities. However, if one were to look back, one would find that there have been demands and movements for reform. And over the years, those reforms have been kind of piecemeal, certainly not radical. And the bottom line underpinning them seemed to be that there was a section of the education community, let us say the grammar school brigade lobby, who did not mind having certain things being done, what I would call tinkering being done, so long as the fundamentals of the original system had not been affected. And to a large extent, that has been quite successful. We find if we go back to 1951 with the demand for the expansion of education, the pressure on government was that the type of schools that were built, the secondary schools that were built, were not to be really in competition with the older secondary schools. And we can speak about that as our callers call in. Then we got to the 11 plus. The 11 plus came about because it was pretty clear to the thinking Barbadians that the system with the newer secondary schools were heavily in favor of the middle and upper classes, and that the working classes were relegated to the newer secondary schools. And rather than really tackle that head on, the authorities were advised to bring the 11 plus from England with a sense of equality of opportunity, and that was the selling point, that since every student would now be sitting the same exam, that those students who fail could not say that they didn't have the same chance as everyone else. And that is a jaundiced view of educational opportunity, and therefore never did bring it and will never bring educational equality in that sense. Then in 1961, which is very important, we had free secondary education, which opened the door for persons of slender means, the working class and so on, to be able to get into the fee-paying schools, some of the fees of which were very high in those days, and that was a pretty big step, one of the biggest steps that was made. However, the actual places in the older secondary schools were not dramatically increased, and so the competition with the 11 plus, although it did help initially working class people, it was soon kind of owned by the middle class, because it was their children who were coached and pushed and had an advantage in getting into the older secondary schools, so that the working class students were still relegated to the newer secondary schools, which have been mistakenly called comprehensives, but that is a misnomer. And it was said by the authorities themselves that the newer secondary schools were no more than glorified primary schools, because they were handicapped, severely handicapped, and therefore could not compete. There was no parity of esteem between the newer secondary school. And so as time went on, it became more and more evident, to the extent that the students themselves were convinced that so long as they did not get into the older secondary schools, that they were kind of second class citizens. And over the years, that has been entrenched, and in many significant ways, that is worse now, I believe, than it even was in the earlier days. To get around some of those ideas in answer to the question that has been asked, the notion of raising of the school leaving age came about, because the newer secondary schools, the students went to school until they were 14, which was almost the same age as they came out of elementary school. And the second thing that was done is that the public was told that the new Education Act placed all schools as being equal, and that was manifestly not so, and is even more manifestly not so today. That was, say, around 1976. Then we came down to, you might skip the 80s, there was an attempt to make some changes. Around 1992, I think Minister Cyril Walker made an attempt to, a bit of radical change. Mm-hmm. And it was heavily opposed by the older secondary schools. In fact, one of the speech days of one of the older secondary schools, the principal of the school castigated the entire idea. And given the political clout of the class of Barbadians that it represented, the idea was actually shelved. Mr. Walker no longer brought that idea. The Headmasters Association, I remember one of our headmasters, literally, with the help of some others, literally presented a plan for the restructuring. And so that did not happen. Then by the mid-1990s, we had another attempt at trying to bring some equality. And again, there was pushback. And without going into great detail, what we ended up with was partial zoning. The zoning concept is a very hard sell in Barbados, mm-hmm. which I hope our callers would look into. And that partial zoning, in many cases, made, and for different reasons and so on, made the newer secondary schools made it even more difficult for them to attract children of the academic bent. And as a result, they suffered tremendously. We had some schools that were built by the World Bank money, where the government actually borrowed huge sums of monies from the World Bank, mm-hmm. foreign exchange. And some of these schools were exceedingly well built, I would say purpose built. I know one of them in particular, I don't like calling school names, but sometimes people would still know who the schools. Mm. But when I got back to Barbados, that was the school at which I taught first. And I was amazed to see the quality of the facilities, the physical structure, the facilities, the apparatus, and if I were to call some of the things that were there, you had teachers' points, like offices for the year heads and heads of departments. You had state-of-the-art industrial arts wing. You had a real modern home ec department. You had science labs that were, you know, like years away from what we had at Corrigan Prairie when I was at school and so on. And the school also had about 50 pieces of instruments donated by the World Bank, which I was fascinated by. I'm not a musician, but I have been really a person who has really pushed music to the limits in the thing. But I was not the principal anyway, but that was the kind of things that were there. And even in the agricultural area, you had anything between half acre to maybe an acre of land in agriculture. And there would have been other schools like that. And the point, the reason why I'm mentioning that is that you cannot go and spend money and bring facilities into the country at that level. And then when you evaluate it a little bit down the line, 20 years hence and so on, you are seeing that the returns are really very, very disappointing. And it is a far cry from what Professor Arthur Lewis advised the Caribbean governments, especially the Barbados government, about in relation to education. And that is that education can no longer be seen as a consumer item or a mere social service, that it is extremely costly. The world is going through an technological revolution. And therefore, the money spent on education must be seen as an investment in manpower development for the country. Okay. So I think that shows how, over the years, the attempts at modernizing and upgrading and reforming the education did not take place. And now there's another attempt that we're at now, which I believe should not fail.
Okay, and we go to the phone lines. It's 9:15. Good morning. It's Let's Talk About It.
Yeah, pleasure. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning. Good morning.
And to the panel.
Thank you. Good morning.
I'm calling to say a big thank you to Barbados Water Authority for coming over to Blazing Number 3 in St. Philip on Wednesday. I had calling earlier this week about the low water, and then the water went out. So they came on Wednesday and fixed the problem, and now we are back on stream for water. So I want to say thank you to the Barbados Water Authority. When we complain, we should come back and say thank you.
Thank you very much, caller. We agree with you. Yes. And we welcome those good stories. Yes, we do. And we go to our... Thank you very much, caller. We know you're an avid Q listener. We go to our next call of the morning. Good morning.
Yes, hi, great morning. How are you doing?
I'm well. How are you?
Oh, glad to hear it. That's wonderful. Come out here.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning.
With Great Parkland's great responsibility and responsible for this call. But I have a couple of questions this morning for Mr. Adams. Good morning to you, sir. How are you doing?
Good morning, sir. I'm anxiously awaiting your questions.
Yeah, you sound well. You're batting well. You gave a fantastic history. Really appreciate all the knowledge. Knowledge is power, and this great podcast got responsibility, you know, so, right. Yeah, so I have my first question in terms of educational reform. Do you believe that schools should be made air conditioned? Do you believe that there should be certain pools at certain schools?
Repeat the question, please.
Do you believe that schools should be made AC? Do you believe that schools should be made air conditioned?
Oh. Mm-hmm.
In the light of our heat illness and children facing in terms of these schools of excellence, in terms of the schools you know, facing with the children with the heat that we're going to face, especially as it gets hotter. There was just a record for the heat in June. I heard there was an article. I would have listened to that. So I just wondered if you believe that our schools should be made, our primary and secondary schools should be made air conditioned, or that they should be given pools or fans or something of the sort to be able for the students to deal with this.
Okay, come on. So,
any other question? Any other question?
The second question has to do with the aspect of the new phenomenon that we're facing now with the gay student.
Yes.
With the special needs student. We didn't have this before in our educational system. And I was wondering if you believe that there should be a psychiatrist in our primary and secondary schools. If they should be, yes, we have guidance counselors, but if you should also place a psychiatrist where they have the added import of the medication that could be faced
with
children going through crisis at this point in time.
Actually, two very good questions, actually.
Well, thank you.
In relation to the air conditioning aspect, it is a good idea, but of course, you know, it's costly, and one would not be able to advocate that should be done widespread across the island quickly. But nonetheless, the concept of the health of the students and so on is a good one, and I believe that individual schools should be able to come up with ideas to be able to deal with that. There are one or two countries and maybe even one or two schools in Barbados where that has happened. I worked in the Bahamas, and there were one or two schools in the Bahamas that were air conditioned. So I don't want to pour any cold water on it, only that it, at the moment, it is somewhat expensive. The other concept of special needs, very, very important in relation to education reform, and the particular areas that you have mentioned, I would say that rather than having just a guidance counselor in a school, in which case it should be in all schools, that one should be looking at teams of social workers and guidance counselors and psychologists and psychiatrists and so on working together as a team, perhaps if not at every single school, in certain areas, certain zones. And the concept of the special needs students should really be looked at. We believe that those students should, in large measure, be included in the mainstream of education. There have been successes here in Barbados and certainly elsewhere in the world where persons who can see and so on have been brought into the mainstream and have done exceedingly well. And so the special needs concept should be looked at in a very systematic way. And so wherever possible, sometimes you would probably need a special school because there's some areas where the extremes would be so difficult. But with advice from the experts, I would tend to agree with you that the special needs students should, in fact, be brought into the mainstream. And we have a gentleman who lives here in Barbados from the UK, Dr. Hornsby, and he is a kind of an expert. He worked in New Zealand, and he's got a doctorate in that area. And he, along with other persons, could be able to advise government in that regard. So I want to thank you very much for that. Idea, because to end off, I think it was the same Professor Lewis who said that the education or quality education in the Caribbean and of course in Barbados should not be privilege of a few. But it should be a democratic right for every person, including the working class, people with special needs. And he mentioned persons who were the offspring of slaves. So the education, the notion of democratizing education, I believe is extremely important and should include the special needs.
Okay, we return to the phone lines. It's 9:22. Good morning.
Blessed good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Sir, I'm trying to call your whole name.
Mr.
Adams.
Alwin Adams.
Sir, Alwin Adams.
Sir, what is
it? You are my sir. Yes, you are. You know you are my sir. And to the panel, and to the everybody there.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
I would like, why do you pronounce Barbados the way you pronounce it? Is there a significant reason or?
I just grew on me. I am pretty sure when I was growing up, I called it Barbados.
Oh, okay.
It could have been, I don't know, living abroad and trying to give it its right, what I would call the certain pronunciation. And so I have continued to do that. And as a matter of fact, at the schools where I, with the principals and so on, the principal and teaching, and the students really like to hear when I am on the platform and talk about Barbados.
I like it too, but I know we are so familiar with Barbados, and I know the educator you are. I thought we were saying something wrong, you know?
Yes.
Okay, and my contribution this morning, I believe that parents should be a little more involved in teachers' associations. I find there's be very little for the parents to do when it comes to parent teachers association. I don't know if that is the reason why some of them get so laid back and don't come to meetings and things the way they should. What was your thought on it?
It is a difficult and a perennial problem. You know, in the past, parents gave over their children, even in the secondary schools, to the school. And it was not the norm for parents to have formal associations like we have it now. So and it's very important to note that in those days, in many cases at the primary schools in particular, and in many of the areas of Barbados where there were secondary schools, the schools were community schools. And the profile of the teacher, the kind of respect of the headmaster and so on, everybody knew the headmaster. And you would hear that you were going to school at such and such a person's school, not even the school by name, but Mr. Adams School or
right.
Mr. Cumberbatch School at St. Giles and so on. And parents confidently almost handed over their
children to
the thing. And when I interviewed Sir Elliot Belgrave about the Boscobel boy, the school in Boscobel, the boys' school there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That came out extremely strongly. The headmaster, Mr. Riley, he virtually dominated the area. Everybody looked up to him. Between himself and the Anglican priests, they controlled the area, and people were quite satisfied to call the children Riley's boys.
Okay.
So coming back to the question though of the PTAs, I think the movement in Barbados away from the community schools, even at the primary level, has fractured that bond between the school and the home and the school and the community. And once that has happened, the parents no longer nor indeed their children no longer have that kind of affinity and closeness to the school. And so the concept of the PTA came into Barbados, but it was never fully bought over by the parents, because as I said, traditionally they felt that the school should do that. The reason really that you're finding that people will not come to PTAs are various reasons. But one of the reasons is that our students have to crisscross the country to schools. You get a situation if you take St. Michael. When I was at College and Parry, for example, I did a survey to find that the majority of the students at the school came from St. Michael, which is a far cry from when I was a student at that school. And when I was at that school, almost 99% of the students came from the north. So the idea of having parents coming from St. Michael down to the country, you know what St. Michael people think about the country.
Mm-hmm. Too far?
It's too far, it's everything else, and people, maybe it's stupid and so on.
Okay.
The point is that that is a one example. There are others where you find that you cannot get a vibrant PTA. You have to do all sorts of things to get the children there. But it is extremely important, because when you break the link between the school and the community, it is like cutting the umbilical cord of a baby without providing the nurturing that the baby needs. And this is what is happening in a very fundamental way in our schools. That umbilical cord has been cut.
Wait, this is what I'm saying, not crossing you, sir. I am saying Saints did find a place for them that need to be utilized, because if you could foster a relationship between parents and teachers, I think it would bring a little, it need to be utilized in a broader way.
Yes, I totally agree with you, because I am a firm advocate for the community school. And in fact, I think this is the crux of one of the fundamental areas of education reform. The education reform will have to be able to convince the various communities across Barbados, in the north, in St. Philip, and various places, that, and indeed, I would go further and say the political persons in the country need to get people to understand that the school in their vicinity belongs to them. There should be ownership of that school. And therefore, when I was coming here, I heard the union speaking about the lack of repairs to schools and so on. That is really a community thing. If the school is a community school, you would not wait till the school has to open on Monday or Tuesday next week to be able to be speaking about repairing the schools and so on.
People in the community would have gone in
and helped. Not that they had to do it themselves, but obviously that would be very important. It would be in their interest to see that the school has been repaired. And that is a fundamental point. That concept of ownership and pride and the dignity that you have in your school. And once you have broken that, you are looking for all kinds of trouble. There's no reason why those parents he mentioned St. George, the union leader. What is about the people that live in that area, that they are at home, and how come they don't know that the school is not in good shape for their children? And that is where the situation is. The same thing with secondary school. So I think you always bring some exceedingly good points.
Thank you.
And our problem here now is to be able to convince people that when schools are and when schools are placed in areas, they are placed for the people in that area.
Yeah.
And the people must be able to be participatory. They are part and parcel of it. They work with the teachers, they work with the ministry. And this is our school.
Sir, I don't want to take up all the time, yes, because I know there are other callers, but I would like to see a program implemented where parents, like bringing a parent every now and again to like sit in the classroom and observe. Because some parents don't know what's going on with the children on a day-to-day basis. They put them off to school and they feel everything. And I am speaking from experience, because as I told you, I work in the system.
Yeah.
Right. So, a parent from time to time, and if he or she got expertise in such subject or something that could talk to the children and interact with the children. I know in primary schools there are.
Okay, yes, we have your point, and I'm saying I hope the authorities are listening, because the concept of teachers' aides and so on can come from parents. Some parents have retired or whatever, they have expertise, and they can be extremely useful in the schools. And this, you make a talking point which should really be headline news.
Thank yes. you. Thank you very much for that contribution. And we go to our first commercial break of the morning. Stay with us. It's Let's Talk About It.
At Coyman, we know every project starts with a vision, a spark of inspiration to build, beautify, construct, and create. And whether you're a construction pro, a home improver, or a decorative DIYer, Coyman has the products, inspiration, and advice to complete your vision to perfection. Everything you need to succeed with every job, every project, every time. Visit us in store or online today at coyman.bb. Coyman, everything you need to succeed.
Wake up, wake up, wake up with Mark Anthony every Saturday and Sunday morning from 5 to 9 a.m. on Q 100.7 FM. He'll give you your daily dose of inspirational music and those soothing tunes to get you through the weekend. Start your weekends the right way with Mark Anthony on Q 100.7 FM. QFM, the heart of the community.
Q fans, the time is getting closer. Q and the community returns to London September 21st at Oakington Manor, Wembley, starting at 2 p.m. Get ready for all the magic of Q in true London Bajan style. And of course, great Q music for dancing. DJs from Barbados, King Scorpion and Dr. Scotty, along with local DJs, and for the live radio broadcast, I'll be there, Kimberly Skeet. Make sure that you follow us to Q in the Community. Buy your tickets now for just £20 for adults, £5 for children at london24.eventbrite.co.uk and go to info@bajanhubuk.com for more information. Q London is here again. Don't you miss it.
I've got my swim cap and comb and my paperback book that I'm almost through.
It's Let's Talk About It on Q100.7 FM with Mr. Alwin Adams, retired educator, author, researcher, Barbadian, well-researched and with much knowledge about our education system and the history of Barbados. We go back to our phone lines. It's 26 minutes to 10. Good morning.
Let's start. Good morning.
Good yeah. morning.
Good morning, Mr. Adams.
Good morning, sir.
How are you?
Well, I'm bearing up. Pretty okay.
You probably I don't know if you can remember this face, but I was the postman at St. Leonard's when you was there.
Yes. Yes, I remember.
The guy with the bicycle?
Yes.
Mr. Barker?
Yes, I remember.
Yes, I remember you very well as well.
You know how hard I worked at that school?
You worked very hard at St. Leonard's. And I worked very hard pushing that bicycle for 25 years too.
Oh dear, congratulations though. I hope you are retired now.
Yeah, I come medically on fit 21 years now, yes.
Yeah, you served well.
I served that area and served the 10 areas that I delivered meals to very well in my 25 years at Eagle Hall.
Yes.
Mr. Adams?
Yes, sir.
I want to, you made 2 points on when you talk about the 11 plus being, making some of our children feel like second class citizens.
Yes.
You made that point on Wednesday, right?
Yes, sir.
And I can't agree with you more because, like I said, I think we need to come with a better system than the 11 plus because I think that system is outdated now.
Yes.
And not only that, you also made the point that our children, our young people that are parents are not spending enough time with their children.
Yes.
Because some of them are working and some of them are curious and some of them are indifferent. They're not sending the children to Sunday school. They're not sending the children to church. They're not sending, because like I said, when church time, in my area, you can see the children just roaming the streets. You can see them playing football.
You can see them playing basketball or hockey, you know, games on the streets. And church is just 2 hours, and they don't send them to church any longer. And they're not spending enough time with their children.
Yeah, okay. Yes, I think that we try to make that point that the school by itself, this is the same, well, repeating the point of the school and the community.
Right.
While the school can, in fact, compensate for some of those shortcomings, the school cannot do it on its own.
That's right.
The school will require tremendous help from various agencies.
Right.
And once that is done, then you would be able to bring those children that you are hinting at that are recalcitrant and what Barbadians call ennuyé.
Right.
That the authorities coming together, we just mentioned social workers, counselors, parents, and things of that nature. Once you can get that in the community, you will be able to kind of forestall some of the serious problems, including crime, that will come later on. A lot of the times, people in discussing crime tend to leave education out.
That's true.
But you know, I think I mentioned last week, sometimes you have to repeat yourself, there were some 950 inmates at the prison. It's not called Glendaria now, it's called Dodds.
Dodds, yeah.
And that they were mainly males, which is a serious thing. But perhaps more significant than that, 95% of them, according to the commandant at the prison, had difficulties in reading and writing, and that they also had no skills. Now, if we could have arrested that at the school level, we would have been able to prevent a lot of those students from ending up in Glendaria Prison. And indeed, it is far more expensive to keep a person in prison. I think at the time they mentioned it was, I'm not sure if it was $35,000 or $3,500, probably $35,000 a year to keep a person in prison. And sometimes we renege from spending the kind of money at the school level, especially the primary school level, and of course the secondary level too. And I think that sometimes we need to, justify the spending of that money, because there was a gentleman, I think Lee Iacocca, from Chrysler, and he said to the United States government that if they think education is expensive, try ignorance. In other words, it is better to spend the money to prevent the crime and so on that it will be coming up than to have to deal with it later on. And therefore, we need to have the right kinds of finances, the right kinds of facilities, the right kinds of personnel in our schools. And I think that that would help tremendously. But very good question, nonetheless.
We thank you, caller, for your contribution. It's 20 minutes away from 10. We move on to our next caller. Good morning.
Let's talk about it. Sir.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, gentlemen. Special good morning to you, Mr. Adams.
Yes, please.
How are you doing, sir?
I am as fine, as fit as ever. I am fit for purpose.
You're fit for purpose?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I hope you wouldn't mind if I insist that, that your findings be subjected to peer review.
Of course.
Mr. Adams, I want to say thank you so much. And a special thank you to CBC as well. And, you know, at the risk of sounding greedy, having you on today reinforces in my mind that this should be an ongoing project, because the quest to reform education is so multifaceted, because as you pointed out, you look to reform the education system as a way of driving social reform, but the act of reforming the education system is itself a project of social reform, because you have to deal with people's attitudes. But as a quick aside before I just make my other point, sir, the earlier caller asked you to explain your pronunciation of Barbados, the port of Barbados, right? And actually, I love when you do it because, in my opinion, saying Barbados, you didn't use that kind of language, but I think you're just playing around. To me, that's just like, you know when Barbados say, not crossing you, mm-hmm. while doing precisely that, or you're insistent on putting lime and fish and salt and killing the people fish.
Yes.
All those are things we do by practice. But when you take the time to critically examine them, you recognize that they don't really add up.
Yes.
So as you pronounce and as BBC always pronounces, is Barbados.
I noticed that Hillary Beckens calls it Barbados as well. but he's a CP man like me, so we are of the same cloth.
Same problems.
Yes, yes.
But Mr. Adams, I would like you please to make a few comments on you spoke on education as a driver of the economy.
Yes.
But I also want you to speak, sir, on education as a driver of intellectual development, where you look into you actually develop your citizenry with a mentality that is discerning, your level of reasoning, your level of consciousness. So you're not just training a guy to do a job.
Yes. Right?
But you're training a person to be actually a human being of higher quality, higher values, and so on.
Yes.
So I'd like you to make some comments on that, please.
Right. I think the point that you were hinting at would be the humanistic side. One of my friends in education tend to call the liberal side of education. And sometimes, I think what perhaps happened over the years in Barbados in particular, is that that side of education and the instrumental side, which is the economic side, I think that they have been looked at in silos, and we have not been able to see that they are intertwined, and therefore the behavioral side of education and the cognitive side of education, and the fact that education is for living, are the kinds of concepts that have been lacking in the education system that had been handed down, really imposed upon us. And in fact, there was a man called Trollope, whose family owned plantation here in Barbados, and he was a very celebrated writer. And he made the point, and Bishop Mitchinson seemed to have been imbued with his ideas, that wherever the whites and blacks coexist, that the white man must give the orders and the black man must obey. In other words, it was ingrained in our education that there was an inferiority-superiority dichotomy in the education, and that the education system should reflect that. Not only should it reflect it, it should perpetuate it.
Reinforce it.
And I think that in a way, that is the point that you are getting at. And to do that, what our education was involved in, and we don't like to say that, was a heavy dose of indoctrination. And brainwashing, and therefore we have been able to imbibe foreign notions rather than looking to see a level of self-sufficiency and gear our education system to meet those needs, and therefore you get a section of our population here in Barbados, and certainly the education community, who tend to feel that there is something drastically wrong with linking education to the economy. They talk about the liberal side of education and so on. But that is an old-fashioned view of education, and it's really a recipe for economic stagnation and decline, and indeed social dislocation. Because I made the point last week, and some people say that I might be saying things over and over again, but the point is that education and the economy are in intertwined. And while it is true that education has other aspects, which you were talking about, the liberal side and so on, the economic side is really the most important, because in the society, no other sector can actually function properly and effectively without an educated workforce.
Okay.
And therefore, any progressive government must move away and shift the emphasis of education away from the notion of education for its own sake and just the intellectual stimulation and so on, and towards the instrumental side of education for living, education for economic development, education for growth. So I think you have brought a extremely significant point there that I believe some other callers may want to take up. But I take your point very well, and I think that education must do both, but certainly the economic side is in my opinion, the area that governments must look at. Education as investment in manpower development for the satisfaction of the production of goods and services locally and for export.
It's 11 minutes away from 10 actually, and we go to our next caller. We thank that previous caller for his contribution. Good morning. Let's talk about it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, good morning.
Yeah, I don't know if Mr. Adams is a historian, but I appreciate he using the history to explain the present. But I have some notions that I would like him to talk about.
Yes, sir.
You know, some last week you were using the word bright. What do you mean by that?
Bright?
Yeah, you're talking about bright children. And
I think everybody would know what we mean. There are some students who, in terms of school work, are sharper intellectually or academically than others, and commonly they are referred to as the bright students.
So you're satisfied with that?
Well, I don't want to split hairs on it, really.
Okay, well, you won't want to avoid it then. My next question is in terms of rights. Do you see education as a human right, absolute human right?
Yes, I just quoted Professor Arthur Lewis in that regard.
I didn't hear that.
And it is deemed by the UNESCO and across the world as a human right, yes.
As a human right.
Not just education, but quality education. We made it, make a distinction.
Yeah. What is?
I would say up to 18, but okay. There might be different opinions on that.
Yeah, I would agree with that. You also must talk about investment, and that you see education as an investment.
Yes.
Is that so?
Yes.
So, that poses a problem, because people who usually invest look for returns, and if the investment don't bring a return, then stop it.
That is true. And that is why education needs to be under the bullseye, you know, the chopping block, because it represents 20% of our budget every year, which is about 8% of our GDP, and is really competing with other aspects of the society, you know, the government ministries and so on, for money. And it is interesting to note that I think I mentioned this last week, just came to the top of my head, that if you were in cabinet and you recognize that education virtually every single year is getting this amount of money and probably more, while you are in agriculture or something, and you are in the dog's house, you are not getting enough money to run your ministry. You may want to raise in cabinet, what is the country getting for this money that is spent on education, when in fact you can't even get good agricultural officers? But that is where the concept of education and the economy comes in, because you need to be able to show at the end of the day that you are getting more youth employment, that you are getting more exports, that your skills base are being built up and so on. And whenever you do that, you have to realize that you are really focusing on education. Some people don't fully understand that. And if the education system happens to fail in those areas, you are going to find a tremendous problem in your economy.
Okay, give me a chance. Suppose you see it as a public good.
Yes, it's a public good, but it's more than a public good. It is more than a social service. And that is the point that Professor Lewis made to the Caribbean governments. He was an economist, but he spent a lot of time on education. And he made the point that because our education system came out of the plantation system, and number one and number two, that it was not initially for the benefit of the masses, that it was for accumulation of wealth by the plantocracy, and their desire to keep the blacks in what Professor Beckford called persistent poverty. Just let me finish
there. Just the second caller.
Yes. Just let me finish there. And therefore, since the world had changed, that might function when the plantation economy, the oppressive economy was there, and to keep the blacks to draw water and cut wood and so on. But in the modern technological world, that is a recipe for disaster.
Okay.
So go ahead.
But if you say as a public good, that doesn't conflict seeing it as an investment?
No. There is no conflict at all, because the public good is dependent upon the school being able to produce educated people for the various parts of the society to function.
Okay, see, that's how you define it.
Yes.
Public good.
Yes.
My definition of public good would be like the air we breathe, fresh air. It doesn't depend by enjoyment of fresh air. Does it affect you, or does it depend on your enjoyment of fresh air? So, going on further though.
Caller, I think that now that you bring the environment and so on, that is directly related to education, because the concept that we're having now with climate change and things of that nature point to an ignorance of persons in authority in relation to the importance of what the science and the whole concept of the society, the good of the society is concerned. So if you do not have an educated society, you are going to have an environment that is detrimental to the health of your people.
Okay, caller, we have to thank you at this point in time for your contribution. We do value all our contributions from our listeners and our callers, our WhatsAppers as well. So we thank you at this point in time, and we move on to our next call. It's 4 minutes away from 10. Mm-hmm. Good morning. Let's talk about it.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
Yes,
sir.
Good morning.
Good morning. I listened to the Mr. Adams, is that your name?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, for quite a while before I decided to call, because I noticed that the road that you're going down is a road of really what happened in the past. We certainly knew what at that time they called grammar school, not grammar school, but you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
Those secondary schools,
yes.
That's the old grammar
yes.
schools.
Yes.
But I have gone beyond that now.
Yes, sir.
Hello?
So have I.
Right. I want you to look at what's happening to this world.
Yes, sir.
When you look at the results in the search area of the older secondary schools, especially Mass, is on the decline for the last 15, 20 years. And it seems to be getting progressively worse, especially areas of mathematics, physics, and chemistry. Yeah. It's so much so that even CSC this year and the other governments are complaining how poor the results was at CSC, Mass, and CAPE. But I cannot talk about Barbados yet because we have not got back those results from CAPE. I want to ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
A child that attended no secondary school, the one that attended all the secondary school, all to get grade threes in Mass. According to a mathematician one time that was given a lecture, the ones that get the high marks to enter school, you expect to do well. The ones that get the lower marks, that could or that could not happen depending on the individual. But is a tendency, if you get the grade threes out of what it says secondary school, that trajectory now change and start to go downwards. Why the one from the know who would get some grades, depends on how many students they were submitting, would see a shift towards an upward trajectory. My question is to you. Years ago, I think you were around here at your time, there was complaints by the Ministry of Education where there were two older secondary schools who the government was saying that they are not getting returns. They were not even getting exhibition scholarships at the time. Do you not see and explain to me what is the problem that in the areas of sets we have fallen on 40?
Well, there could be a lot of reasons for that, and sometimes we do not get the precise information. But the results in science from the older secondary schools, we try not to call names, but you know, people know the schools, they tend to be pretty satisfactory from the older secondary schools. From the
Let me stop you,
sir, please you please allow Mr. Adams to finish his point.
You got your opportunity to speak, so yes.
Allow Mr. Adams to respond to your comment.
Only last week, I don't know if I could find the sheet here with me, but the chief education officer had made the point that the results in maths and English were not that particular year, Chief Education Griffith Watson. And she went on to say that of all the thousands of students that sat those subjects, only a small percentage got grade one and grade two. But she also went on to say that the overwhelming number of students who got the grades one and two came from four secondary schools in Barbados. What we are seeing is that we want to have quality education in all of our schools so that this distinction between your secondary and older secondary and so on needs to be done away with. And we need to have a cross-section of students in our schools coming out of our primary schools that would be no longer hamstrung by teaching students to pass the 11 plus, where virtually every single year, according to results from the Ministry of Education, and I have some of them here in front of me, probably including this very year, show that with great regularity, in fact, you can predict it, that large numbers of students are going to fail. And if they're failing in English and maths, they are going to fail in science as well. So we need to reform our education system to have quality education. I think that we have concentrated on quantity. We have concentrated on the fact that we have all of our children going to primary and secondary schools, and we feel that that is an end in itself, and that is equality of education. That is not
mere attendance.
It is not equality of education. Equality of education is a step further, because that is only a means to an end. The step further is to have those students who have access to primary and secondary education, what are the outcomes? So it is equality of outcomes. You move from equality of opportunity to equality of outcomes, so that the money that you are spending on education is able to produce or close to the number of scientists and other people and so on that you need in your society. So I think that is where the issue is, although I appreciate the point that you're making.
Your final comment, caller, before we go to a commercial break.
My final comment is, Mr. Addison, that you have to look and see what the world has said, that it's going to things, the professions that is going to drive the world economy. And that's where you see that places like China spends a lot of their money on science, medicine, and technology, because that is what is driving the world economy. And with a new branch of mathematics now, which is introduced to students in China, near quantum mathematics, you can see there are some degrees that are very difficult to get into, which they call the harder degrees. I mean, if you cannot do these basic things, your chance of qualifying for one of those harder degrees will become slimmer and slimmer. So you will have to look at your teaching methods. And teaching methods nowadays is different than your time, because teachers in Mars at those other places overseas don't take that time to explain that very much. You are expected to do most of the work on your own. So I suggest that instead of we're looking and see, solve the problem. But before I go on, Mr. Addison, there's one final thing I got to tell you.
Caller, yes, I allowed you to make your final comment. I can't allow you
to go
on.
You're not sure where you're
any
going, really.
Longer. We have to go to a commercial break, and we thank you for your contribution. We encourage you to call us next week. This is Let's Talk About It. The program continues in just a moment.
Please note the following temporary changes to our programming on Q100.7 FM for Let's Talk About It. On Monday, September the 9th, Reverend Charles Morris returns to the chair to discuss the issues of the day. Let's Talk About It, the Elder Affairs Edition, with Patrick Estwick and George Griffith, will be aired on Wednesday, September the 11th. Q100.7 FM, the heart of the community.
Stay connected and stay entertained with MCTV. Make your MCTV payments on or before the last day of the month and never miss your favorite movies and shows. For your convenience, MCTV payments can be made online through the Bank of Nova Scotia, CIBC First Caribbean, the Royal Bank of Canada, First Citizens Bank, or SurePay online, or at any post office or SurePay location. You can also utilize our cashier or Dropbox facility located at our offices at CBC The Pine. MCTV, entertainment for everyone.
Follow me to Q in the Community this Thursday. Q in the Community is sponsored by Banks Beer, Deputy, Guinness, Guinness Smooth, Dasani Water, Minute Maid Juice, Smirnoff Ice, Smirnoff Vodka, Johnny Walker, Black and White Whiskey, Barefoot Wines, Rida Hard Wines, Pepsi, Juicy, 7-Up, White Rock Ginger Ale, White Rock Soda Water, Angostura White Oak Rum, and Fernandez Black Label Rum.
Stay connected and stay entertained with MCTV. Make your MCTV payments on or before the last day of the month and never miss your favorite movies and shows. For your convenience, MCTV payments can be made online through the Bank of Nova Scotia, CIBC First Caribbean, the Royal Bank of Canada, First Citizens Bank, or SurePay online, or at any post office or SurePay location. You can also utilize our cashier or Dropbox facility located at our offices at CBC The Pine. MCTV, entertainment for everyone.
And we're back. It's 6 minutes past 10 here in Barbados and across the Eastern Caribbean. This is Let's Talk About It on Q100.7 FM. We go to a few WhatsApp messages before we return to our phone lines.
Mr. Adams, an individual is responding to your comments regarding parental activity in the PTA the Parent Teacher Association. They're saying his grandson goes to school at the Alwin school. He lives in St. Michael. His daughter works in Christchurch, and they would have to wait several hours to get to St. Andrew to participate in the PTA meetings.
Yes.
So they're in a sense agreeing. Yes. Yeah. In a sense, they're agreeing with you that
it's a very significant point because you live in St. Michael. I'm not sure if it's in the inner city, but the point is that St. Michael has about 100,000 people, and St. Michael should have its good schools for St. Michael's people, particularly, say, the inner city where problems are, so that the students from St. Michael should have quality primary schools and secondary schools, and that, for the most part, the children should have access to those quality schools in St. Michael. And I think the system that we have militates against that, even more so than in the past. Last week I mentioned, usually don't want to call names, but substantial number of students came from Carrington Village and the Back Ivy and places like that, even Wellington Street and so on, down in Lakes Folly. And they went to what were called the prestige schools in St. Michael. You find it extremely difficult now for that to happen. And this is really a kind of a moving away from what is happening in some countries across the world in relation to inner city schools, because the record will show, and we should research it, that the inner city schools of London, with all of its myriad social problems and so on, with a comprehensive system of education, outperform all other areas in Britain, which really, you could say, give a lie to the fact that going comprehensive and moving away from grammar schools would bring a decline in performance of students in school. There has been absolutely, and I said that last week and nobody seemed to challenge it, but there have been absolutely, there's no evidence at all to prove that that is so. If you go to Canada, if you go to the Scandinavian countries, and Britain is leading the world now in terms of the production from London, having gone comprehensive since 1969, and the records I called out last week indicate that every single year the results improved, to the extent that some 81% in 2010, and since then it's even higher, with students with 5 or more O levels and so on. We are not getting that kind of performance from the system that we have, and yet we want to pretend that it is the best system in the world, that it is sacrosanct, that there is no alternative. That is what Canute Thompson said, T-I-N-A, that there is no alternative. When in fact, the actual evidence and the facts indicate that the system is failing. And in Barbadian terms, if you are faced with hard facts that show that the system is failing, and yet you go around saying that it is the best system and that the world will come to an end if it were to change, it is just like believing in Obia. I don't think that it has any basis in fact whatsoever, and it is really ignorance masquerading as wisdom. And I think that the Barbadian public, as they get to realize both an insight into the history, as they get to recognize the lack of performance of our students, cannot other than say that the system has been failing. And somewhere before we finish, I will try to show that the ILO, that CARICOM, that the president of the Caribbean Development Bank, that Dr. Downs, all those people have looked at our system and show that it is not doing the things that the general public have been told that it is doing. And therefore, that is why there is this great need for the reform of education. The reform of education is not a whim and a fancy. it is a result of years of dismal failure in several areas, and that in the modern world we have to change in order to keep up with the rest of the world. Thank you.
Okay, the final WhatsApp I'll read before we return to the phone lines. This individual is suggesting that the qualifications for the teaching profession should be standardized.
Yes.
All schools should be equipped with science labs, music and art rooms. Mm. And they are suggesting the expansion of the school meal service. Yes. To include all secondary schools.
Goodness. And also students with special needs and so on.
Yes.
But I think what the person is dealing with is the need, in my opinion, for the establishment of a teacher's service commission. Mm-hmm. And it is long overdue. I believe that the unions should declare their hands in that regard, because what it will tend to do, it will tend to take the teaching profession out of the public service commission and out of the standing orders and so on. And it will lay down the criteria for the professionalization of teaching. And therefore, the recruitment of teachers, the training of teachers, the promotion of teachers, the evaluation of teachers, the standards, the minimum standards of facilities in schools, mm-hmm. actually the behavior of students and teachers and conduct of teachers, all of those things should be part and parcel of teacher reform, of education reform, and should be brought into the mix. I think so far we probably have not seen it discussed at any great length, but when you come to think about it, you cannot really reform the education without having the teachers with you. And so, along with the things that I have said, you want to have the unions to see that you will even restructure the management system of education that will bring something more for the teachers and the principals and so on in the schools. For example, I mentioned last week two deputy principals. I mentioned this morning the notion of having teams of social workers and counselors and so on working together. I want to mention the fact that you need to attract bright young men like the two of you guys here that Sherwood has doing some very good work. Men like you, we don't want to move you from here, but we want to have good young men in bright young men in teachers, in teaching. And in order to do that, you have to put on the table what you might call a win-win situation. The teachers must be able to see that there's something in the reform for them, both from the point of view of their professionalization, from the point of view of their economic well-being, the point of view of their pensions and wages and things of that nature. And it is very crucial, and their discipline and promotion and so on, that you have a teaching service commission that will look into those things and give the teachers a lift and give the union something to talk about, to come to the table for. And I believe that particular question, to my mind, bring that sort of thing into consideration.
Okay, 434-1007, or you can call us at 434-1070. We welcome your contributions, call and engage us. Good morning, let's talk about it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes. How are you, Mr. Adams?
Oh, I'm very well, thank you.
And to your guests. Because I know you're supposed to be guests, but right now you're educating those two gentlemen there.
My dear, two giants, man. I am.
You're educating them. Right now you're on the guest. You're the main man. Mr. Adams, I want to do some corrections of certain things that you said.
Yes, sir.
I hope I'm pretty right. Now, last week you speak about somebody that got a child that lived 9 minutes from St. Michael's School.
Yeah.
Before they send them up to Christchurch.
Yeah.
Now, that's why he was telling you about the buses that the government should give the schools, the buses, because basically how the system set up,
as the people from town, children from town shall go to the country, and the people from the country like will go into town to schools, and you know, that's the most of it, that the bus, the trans, the not the even thing with transport, what bus or not, it was this minibus. So the minibus could make money, was a trade for the minibus. So you move the people from town to the country and the people from the country to the town. That's what happened with the education system there.
So what are, right, not crossing you, what are you supporting? You're supporting the fact that the child should go from next door to St. Michael to Christchurch?
No.
Oh, okay.
I'm saying that's what the system have done. Move the people from the town.
Yes.
Out to the country.
Yes.
Now if you go to Garrison Secondary, how much children that live around there's got the Garrison Secondary? All those people going to like Ellerslie and other schools.
Yes.
You know, so that's all the system do. So that children got to move from transportation. But mainly was the minibus to give minibus a trade. Mm. And that's all that mash up the everything.
I mean, you are pretty revolutionary in your thinking, because you said it was done to give the minibuses a trade.
I have never heard that said before. That's what the minister said at the time.
Yes.
Of course.
That part slipped me though, but that's interesting.
You can't know everything. No, there's nothing that you know about. But that was the whole idea for a trade for the minibus, so the minibus people could make money. So that would send the children from the town to the country, and the people from the country to the town to provide the trade morning and evening.
Well, I cannot fault you for bringing that in, because if you are saying that you know that that has happened, that is so. But what I was trying to say though is that it is the structural aspect of the education that has brought that into play, and that unless you change the structure, you will not get away from that aberration.
You change the structure to this. The structure used that you will go to school in your community close to home.
Correct.
And all of a sudden you turn around, get people from that closer school, go to some other school.
Yes.
You know, it's just not, to me, it's nonsense.
Which part of the island are you from, caller?
I'm from St. George.
St. George, yes.
Yes,
but you know what has happened though, is that a beautiful school has been built in St. George and it has been stigmatized.
But that's the whole thing.
And the government will have a tough sell on its hands.
But look at the beautiful people that school produced, though.
Yes.
You know, what should be thing?
And in that valley and all that sort of thing, and it is the structure of our system that has demonized the school, and therefore, what the government will have to be able to do over time is to demonstrate that this school is a quality school. And you have a community in St. George with, you know, open air places. It doesn't look like a poverty stricken places and so on and so on. And it has a very upmarket private school up there, and should have an upmarket public school, because the average person in the St. George community will not be able to send their child to the upmarket school. That should be left to the upper crust. But the people from the area with, you know, means that are not, you know, the pockets are not deep, to put it in Barbadian terminology, they should be able to have a quality school in St. George for the persons in St. George. And St. George should not be peopled by persons coming out of Bridgetown.
Of course not. But look at the great people that went to St. George Secondary School. That didn't know as much as they
did. Oh, yes. Well, Hartley Henry and persons like that.
I was going to call his name.
Came from there, some other people that I know.
I was going to call his name, and reefers and all those great reefer cricketers,
yes,
and all those,
yes,
people that went there.
Yes.
Right? But they had...
And a beautiful area.
Very beautiful. And only because it built on a plantation land. But large built on plantation. I think Cormier built on... But we don't... Give them the thing,
yeah.
But you get St. George just because it belongs on constant plantation land.
Yeah, that is the difficulty, caller, that the government has. But it is not unsurmountable, because what we have to do is to be able to convince communities that we are having quality primary schools. Mm-hmm. And like, for example, this morning I heard the president of the union saying that the St. George Primary School is you know, having difficulties with its infrastructure and so on. That is something that, you know, that the local persons should have known that long before the school is ready to open, because that is their school. The other thing that we want to bring local people into is the fact that when we had the World Bank money to build the primary schools, I'm not so sure if we had enough local input in the style of those primary schools. And sometimes we find that they don't have enough recreational areas. I look at the one, I believe that was a World Bank school too, George Lamin School, built almost in the road. And you wonder how a big school like that would be able to have the children at that age to really stretch their legs and to do the kind of things that they ought to do, and to have a cricket pitch, this be a cricketing nation. All of those things have to be taken into consideration, and those are the shortcomings of the present system that we inherited, and we cannot afford to carry that anymore.
We inherited. Let me move and make another point.
Very quickly.
Yes, when the young world was talking about when they stopped sending children out of school at 14, it was in 1976.
Yes.
When the BLP government gets into power, that was a campaign promise that they're going to send the children back to school.
That is correct.
And I was one of the children that get sent back to school. I get sent at the modern secondary school, London High School there. And the beautiful thing about the modern way, the modern was so bright, children were so bright there. As you watch the modern was so cold. The monk of almond, tombering trees and things. The areas were so cool, was so good for learning. Right, so yes. I believe that was the real way, because mother has some real bright children.
Yes.
Bright people, you know.
Yes, so we thank you, caller, for your contribution.
Thank you
very much.
You good points.
Yes, it's 24 minutes past 10. We move on to our next caller. Good morning. Let's talk about it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Alwin Adams.
Good morning.
All the other gentlemen there in the who's helping with the panel.
Good morning.
I'd just like to say that you made a point. I've never done this before. Please excuse me.
Okay.
But you made a point there that early in it, which I remembered was something that happened early in my life.
Yes.
I came from very humble beginnings, and there was a school which taught very well and had, I hasten to add, it was half white at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And the rest of the children were people who had some money and others who were poor perhaps, but the children were bright and they still managed to get them into the school.
Yes.
I was none of that. But however, my mother, you mentioned about children being in one area and having to go miles away to a school just because of whatever reasons they might be. But in this case, although my mother could not afford to pay exorbitant school fees for that school, which they were would appear at the time, that's the way it appeared anyway, because in terms of what we worked for, my mother was a seamstress and she only got 36 cents a week or something for each dress or
it is. Go ahead.
So therefore, she obviously couldn't make that, you know, get me into the school and give me everything, my uniforms, my books, my whatever, school fees. She went down, that's the sort of woman she was. She went down and found one of the people that were on the board. They were all white people on the board, and she went to one of them, and she expressed herself very clearly, and she had me there with holding me by, I was 8 years old, and she had me holding by my little hand, and so that they could see that I was only little.
Yes.
Anyway, and she told him exactly what I just told you. She cannot afford it, but she is not sending her child to a school in Bridgetown just because she happens to be poor. And I went to Alexandra School for 10 years.
Hear, hear.
You see, it caught my attention when you mentioned this business of going away far to different schools. Just because you're not in a position, that you could send it, you have the money and have everything, to, you know, you needed to. And there you are. However, I do listen a lot, but I've never spoken, but that caught my attention this morning.
Good. I am so glad to hear that you came from the north and went to Alexandra School.
Yes, I did. I was not one of the very brightest children, but fortunately, I always liked maths and English. I liked arithmetic, as they would call it when I was smaller. Younger, I liked that, and I liked my dictation and stuff like that. So I excelled in math and English, and that's all I needed to take myself off to England. As soon as I reached 19, I said bye-bye, because I told you my parents were poor. I said bye-bye, mommy and daddy. I am off to seek my own fortune. You can't do anything else to me. I have to do it now for myself.
Yes.
You've done enough. And off I went, and I spent my time down there till I could work for my own home.
Yes,
that's you.
Meanwhile, I traveled to and fro as they needed me.
Madam, I did it. Yes, madam, you made a very good point. I just reinforce the point that I was making, that you should have quality schools in the north, and they should attract the students from the north in terms of economics of the family and things of that nature.
Yes.
And they should be assured that they can compete with any other school, any part of the island.
Indeed.
And that is how you get the upward mobility in our system, but not the notion that the only way you can succeed is if you go to one or two schools.
Yes. Ma'am, we thank you for your contribution, and she's a first-time caller, she mentioned. We thank you very much
thank you very much, ma'am.
And for your anecdotal contribution. It's 28 minutes past 10. We go to commercial break. This is Let's Talk About It.
Please note the following temporary changes to our programming on Q100.7 FM for Let's Talk About It. On Monday, September the 9th, Reverend Charles Morris returns to the chair to discuss the issues of the day. Let's Talk About It, the Senior and Elder Affairs edition, with Patrick Estwick and George Griffith, will be aired on Wednesday, September the 11th. Q100.7 FM, the heart of the community.
That's the sound of your animals. Strong, healthy, and delivering yields you love. That didn't just happen. It began with you feeding them only the best. East Caribbean Feeds. Rest assured, we only produce your feeds with premium ingredients. No hormones, no animal byproducts. Just everything your animal needs for maximum nutrition. Because your animals deserve only the best. East Caribbean Feeds for maximum nutrition.
ECGC Feeds are still here with better prices than before. With island-wide delivery available at Walk Springs Group, Inc., St. Thomas. Hopeless Variety, Inc., Marchfield, 6 Roads, St. Phillips. Feed Shed, Constitution, Van Stand. Telephone numbers 826-2168, 537-0089, and 851-1160.
Follow me to Q in the Community this Thursday. Q in the Community is sponsored by Banks Beer, Deputy, Guinness, Guinness Smooth, Dasani Water, Minute Maid Juice, Smirnoff Ice, Smirnoff Vodka, Johnny Walker, Black and White Whiskey, Barefoot Wines, Rida Hard Wines, Pepsi, Juicy, 7-Up, White Rock Ginger Ale, White Rock Soda Water, Angostura White Oak Rum, and Fernandez Black Label Rum.
Join Apostle David Durant and the team from Restoration Ministries International every Saturday at 12 noon for Restoration Inspiration on Q 100.7 FM. God is restoring all things. He is refreshing the saints and reviving the nations. Restoration Inspiration, put in some inspiration into your Saturdays.
Don't miss some of the biggest stories of your day every day at 1 p.m. in the CBC News World at 1. That's when CBC News highlights what happened and what you need to know. Listen in every day thanks to our partners, the National Insurance and Social Security Services, Nichols Bacon Company, Laurie Dash Craft Shop, and Great Health Works. The CBC News World at 1, credible and relevant across the stations of the CBC.
MCTV just scored a massive goal!
The English Premier League is back on MCTV's ESPN. So, round up your team and catch every thrilling moment of EPL action live on ESPN. MCTV just won the game!
And we're back, 28 minutes to 11 here in Barbados and across the Eastern Caribbean. This is Let's Talk About It on Q100.7 FM. We return to our phone lines. Good morning. Let's talk about
good morning.
It.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, sir. Good morning, gentlemen.
Yes,
good morning.
Adam.
Good morning.
Special good morning to you, sir.
Yes, sir.
As a former St. Leonard's boy.
Well, there.
It appears that I came about probably 2 years after you said you went off in 61. So Mark Williams was also there.
Yes.
And Romeo and Greiner.
Right.
Along with Mighty Gabby.
Yes.
And those that you had mentioned, because you have mentioned so much things in this educational aspect and also historical aspect, because all people don't like people to look back. I find today generation, people don't want to hear about what had transpired back then.
Yes, when you shed the light, it brings, you know, a lot of unwelcome things that people feel that should be swept under the carpet. Go ahead.
This is what we and others experience. They don't comprehend it, and they should appreciate what they have today, although that it ain't what you really want it to be.
Yes.
Because as you mentioned, the elimination of the people in St. Michael's, I told a lot of the guys when that happened shortly after they left Lindsay Hall, I said, listen, this is one of the guys telling that some of you that could have gotten the school team in St. Michael's, you're out.
Yeah.
And one thing I despise in the school, that at St. Leonard's, I was very relentless to my teacher, and I was saying, I cannot comprehend how boys are moving from class to class, and they haven't merited. I said, look what common mayor does. You in the form of common mayor, you don't excel. They hold you in that class till you excel to get over it. And that was something that a lot of boys did the best. But yeah, they was telling you, you ain't moving on. If you don't make it here, the same as another school.
Mm-hmm.
That's how it used to be.
Right. Go ahead.
As you said, go ahead. There was people that also, the back door was always people of substance that had business in there. As we know, they come to the school, and the children get in the school, and other boys get out. I had the belief that I had passed 11 classes. My teacher used to be walking me all around with the hall, showing off my work. Only two boys in the school had the same surname. We had the same surname, but we didn't know if we was family or not, but mm-hmm. we was in the same class. And the morning they were reading out, they called out the names going to come here, or we decided we want to go to come here. We were holding hands.
Mm-hmm.
And he's telling me, you pass, God. And I said, Trevor, you pass. And next thing, the game master come over and read out Mr. Corson, calling up the names down here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Make up.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Make up.
Yes, sir. You have you have a question for Mr. Adams related to education. I know you're giving your experience and your knowledge of what pertained back then, mm-hmm. and you're highlighting the importance of history as it relates to education. But in your view, what do you believe needs to be changed in our education system today? What reforms do you believe are necessary?
Well, my reform is something that I strongly believe in, and I have made that quite explicit. I think the curriculum is what needs to be changed, because I spoke about that about 5 years, in 2015.
Yeah.
I brought that up in a discussion, and I think that the curriculum needs to be changed, that we will be producing people to suit.
Right, yes.
Yeah.
When you say it needs to be changed, to add what or to take what from the current curriculum?
Well, as government had stipulated that they were going to technical aspects and different schools that they
mm-hmm.
want to produce to suit what is going on in today's world,
mm-hmm.
first thing I think that government has to do is that they need the facilities, they need the equipment, they're going to need the personnel. And unless you get what you need to assist the students that you want to push in a direction, technically and otherwise, mm-hmm. it is not going to happen.
So you, from your perspective, you believe there needs to be greater focus on TVET, technical and vocational education and training?
Yeah, the technical aspect, because a lot of people just thinking that the old time way with getting certification and starting saying that I qualify.
Right, the focus on academia.
Yeah,
academia. That don't exist no more.
Yes. Yes. We're seeing increasingly now that skills training are indeed important in today's society. But caller,
yes, caller.
I'm in the city.
Yeah, I really am very pleased with your contribution and your comments, and I believe that coming from St. Leonard's, that might have helped your perspective, the fact that when you were asked what you would suggest in terms of the reform, you immediately highlighted the shift towards technical vocational and some way, and at least to bring it on par, give it some parity with the academics. I think that is particularly important, because up to this present day, it is deemed to be kind of low status in relation to the high status subjects and so on. And your input is making the authorities recognize that more emphasis should be in that area, and that the present system that we have is not in the best interests of the economic development of the country, and that if we are to maintain the young people and to prepare them with the requisite skills and the requisite knowledge and so on to compete with the best in the world, and to be able to help to grow our economy, that we would need to be able, coming out of our schools, to have students with those kind of skills. So I think that was the main point that you made. It is a reinforcing point, but it is one that needs to be said over and over again, because the academic side of our education is entrenched in the system, and it is very difficult to have the move towards the technical and vocational, and get the system that we inherited from the British off of our backs. Yes. So I think you made some very good points there.
Indeed, it's 21 minutes away from 11. We go on to our next caller. Good morning. Let's talk about it.
Yes, hi. Good morning, gentlemen. Mr. Adams.
Good morning.
Yes, good morning, Adrian.
Yes.
Good morning.
Okay, Mr. Adams.
Yes, sir.
You are speaking there, and you taught me so much. I love these programs. I love how you did with the history, and you almost had me convinced. When I say I almost had me convinced, when you bring back the history and show me how 11 Plus was born here in Barbados,
yes,
I was on board with you, right?
Yes, sir.
Because I was saying, change it, right?
Yes.
And you say that, but I'm saying, I don't think we should change it. Just listen, I want to find out. I just want to place this in. I don't want to change it.
Uh-huh.
I want the 11 plus continue.
Yeah.
But it's the zoning the schools, you know, as mm-hmm. you rightfully saying, persons that live around the schools, I prefer that you place them into the schools around there.
Mm-hmm.
It's like assessing the children. You know, you taught at St. Leonard's. You know, if someone passes St. Leonard's to go into the 1-1, 1-2, 1-3, 1-4, and it used to be done by age. You enter that school and go into 1-4 if you're born in March, right? Mm-hmm. After you do the classes inside there and you did well, they put you in like 2-1 or 2-4 or 2-8. All depends how you do, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think that was the system at St. Leonard's. Am I correct? I'm not sure.
Maybe when you were there, but go ahead. I'm following you.
Right. So if we do continue 11 plus and assess people and place these people that are in, let me say, everybody in St. Michael, into St. Michael's schools and help them to grow,
mm-hmm.
I think the problem is primary schools. Teachers at primary schools are not doing what they're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
You got to assess and see who
is capable of moving up the ladder. When I say moving up the ladder, because you know all of us don't develop our brain the same time.
All right. Yeah, caller, I think I've gotten got your point. You believe that you really don't want to get rid of the 11 plus, because it seems to me as though you think that there should be some form of testing in order to move on. But the 11 plus is not the ideal form of testing, that there are several other forms of assessment that are very useful and have been used across the world in relation to seeing where children are. And in many cases, they're diagnostic, and they're not used. In fact, you know, people don't really understand that the real purpose of the 11 plus, from the time it was introduced into Barbados, was to allow 3 or 4 or 5 schools to select the children with the highest marks, and then left the other children for other schools. And that is certainly not correct. And let me tell you what a famous writer in Barbados, who seems to be in favor of the 11 plus as well, but this is what he said, I think these are his virtually very words. And he said in a volume from the museum, the 60th anniversary of the museum journal, he said that what the 11 plus has done since 1958-59, when it was brought to Barbados from Britain, is to enhance the schools high in the pecking order of selection while confining other schools as pedagogical dumping grounds, relegated persistently to the lower rungs of the education ladder. Now that is how he sounding phrase there's there, because the gentleman is you know, very well versed in language. But what he is saying is that the 11 plus that you said you would want to maintain has always been about maintaining certain schools as the elite schools in the high pecking order. And the language that is used, that was used by the gentleman, he talked about pedagogical dumping grounds. That is, immediately, it is causing certain types of schools in this country to be stigmatized for the students who attend those schools or who are sent to those schools to be feeling that they're not as good as other schools, as other children from other schools. And therefore, I believe that while the points that have been made about the change in the curriculum and so on are good, that I do not believe there can be any meaningful reform in Barbados without the abolition of the 11 plus, and indeed the grammar schools, and that we should move to a comprehensive type of education. The type of neurosecondary schools that we have now are not comprehensive schools. And the comprehensive schools would allow students from the area of different abilities to go to the same school. And with mixed abilities, teachers would be trained to teach those students. And the idea that mixed ability classes perform worse than our homogeneous classes. Again, I can't go into all the details here, but there is no evidence across the world to show that that is so. And that if you look at the, I want to digress a little bit here in a way, it's not really digression. If you look at the British cabinet now with the Labour government that got into Britain, about 90% of the ministers in that cabinet are from comprehensive schools. And even Theresa May herself went to a comprehensive school for a longer period than she went to a grammar school, because her grammar school was changed into a comprehensive school. But yet, there are some people in Britain who want to maintain that system, and there are about 5% of grammar schools still in Britain. But the point is that all of the improvements in education in Britain came from the comprehensive schools. So St. Leonard's that took the brunt of the education change in Barbados has been a neglected school. I can tell you that I worked there, and I can say here without fear of contradiction that it almost killed me, in order physically and everything else, in order to bring it, try to bring it up to the kind of standards. And I can't say that I totally succeeded, but I wanted to get the esteem of the students and even the teachers. And that was not easy, because every single year when the 11 plus marks came to the school, at first we would go and get them and so on, you would scarcely get students on that list who had marks 50 or above. And I just want to make the point that it was, I found it to be fairly ridiculous that after those students, and there were 240 more than at any other older secondary school, with all the difficulties that we had at the school, when I got to the school, I found that the teachers would then take those students, go through the list, and take out the ones with the very best marks of the bad marks, and put them in one class, so that of the eight schools, and I want the public to know this, of the eight classes at St. Leonard's, when you got down to 1-8, you wouldn't get a child in 1-8 that had more than 30 marks. And we let me tell you what Gladstone Holder said here. Gladstone Holder said that the white paper speaks about local students leaving school without proper certification, and over 1,000 score under 30% in the 11 plus exam. He wrote that in 1995. And I have some statistics with me in the 1980s, where over 1,000 got less than 20% between 0 and 19. And all of those students, this is a disgrace, all of those students are dumped into certain schools. That is why the writer, this is not my language, the writer said that refers to the schools as pedagogical dumping grounds. And the country has to move away from that, because it means that the primary schools are socialized into that kind of production and productivity, or lack of productivity. And unless the 11 plus has impinged, in other words, it has pushed itself down into what is done in the primary schools, and as a result, the primary schools are producing too few students that are at the acceptable level. And I've been saying that, I say it over and over again. And Gaston Holder went on to say that I suggested in my column that it is impossible for children not mentally handicapped to be illiterate after 6 and 7 years of schools in the primary school. That is where I would say the Prime Minister is talking about reforming this education system, because that cannot be allowed to persist in the modern world. What will happen between now and 2050? I wouldn't be around, but it would be a total disaster in this country.
Okay, we return to our phone lines. It's 10 minutes away from 11. Good morning, caller. Let's talk about it. Good morning. You're live and on air. We welcome your contribution. Good morning, caller. I guess we seem to have lost that caller.
Okay.
Okay, Josh, we have a WhatsApp contribution that I will read in case that caller decides to call back. The individual is saying, in addition to the reforms that we are speaking of this morning, the names of the schools should also be changed to remove the stigma of certain newer schools from the society. Mm-hmm. What do you think of that?
It's a very interesting point, and it is not one that I give a lot of thought to. But when you come to think about it, there have been some schools already that have been renamed. Sometimes I'm not 100% sure why they were renamed. The primary school, one of the primary schools I attended, St. Boniface and Black Bess, they were combined. And this is on Highway 2A. And the school is now called Gordon Greenwich School. Which is a good thing, I suppose. But because Gordon Grinders, I think, went to Black West School. I went to both of those schools, actually. Mm-hmm. And so that was a change of name, in the sense that Gordon Greenwich has been able to elevate himself in the sporting world and so on, and that is a very good idea. Once you can bring probably what I would say good reasons for doing so, I perhaps believe that it may help, but I haven't given a lot of thought to it. But the gist of what the caller is getting at, in my opinion, is the stigma, that stigmatization that is ingrained in certain schools, and it is not only the fact that the students themselves see themselves as things, but students from other schools see those children as lesser. Mm-hmm. And it is bringing a level of divisiveness into the society at a time when we should be having cohesive movements in terms of our republic. And we can only get that cohesiveness if, as Professor Lewis was saying, that you have this education system not for a privileged few, but for the majority of the population as a right. And one of the points that the caller is making, that it cannot easily be done if the names of some schools remain. And he may have a point. I understand where he's coming from. And he may have a point there.
Mr. Adams, do you believe, how long you believe it would take to eliminate the stigma of the newer schools from the society? Because, you know, you will still have those who believe in the high school, low school, yes, and the old boys school club and that kind of thing. So how long do you believe it would take to eliminate that stigma from society once we reform the education system?
Yes, I could use the experience that I gained living in the United Kingdom. Mm-hmm. And they actually, as a result of revulsion, mm-hmm, from unions, from parents, all sectors of the community, that is why it was actually changed. It was not changed just for Seoul. Mm-hmm. They changed in 1969. Mm-hmm. And they were able to bring the British population with them. I think at the moment we have not been able to do that. I think we need to have a mission critical movement in Barbados, where the nation, we can entice and encourage various sections of the community to come together, if you call it a round table, whatever you want to do, to show that it is not only in the interests of the country as a whole, which is very important, but that it is in the interest of the various sectors of the community to change the system. Once we can get that and you recognize that you can move from this divisive system into a comprehensive system, that is actually what the country doesn't know, Barbadians don't seem to know, that the comprehensive system is used virtually in every powerhouse nation in the world. And once you have shown that that has happened and that it did not bring degradation and decline in those countries, I would say over a 5 to 10 year period you can do that. But you have to have that national movement. I think that we underestimated the opposition to the movement, and the opposition from a significant sector or section of the Barbadian public. I also believe, and this is my belief, it might be controversial, that the persons that have been in charge of education in Barbados, and this happened in the UK too, because they themselves, and the politicians really, I think I must say that because I think it's true, because they themselves have been products, we ourselves, put it this way, I am of one of those products of the status quo of the present system. that we are extremely reluctant to change it. And therefore, once we have recognized the difficulty involved, and we can get people to recognize that it is in the national interest to do so, I would say it would take 5 to 7 years.
Okay. I understand what you're saying, Mr. Adams. But in a post-reform world, and one of the callers spoke to, I think it was Kamal who spoke to climate resilience, building that into the physical school plants.
Yeah.
What do you envision education looking like in the post-reform world, taking climate change into consideration, taking differently abled students into consideration, and being more comprehensive? In terms of the contribution to the economy, what do you foresee?
Yes. I think overall that it would be useful to the economy, but one has to look at the funding. Some of the schools would have to be restructured and physically and so on. Some of them would have to look to have a different form of organization. And these are not impossible, because once the organization of the reorganization of a school plan, if the persons can see that they're going to benefit, it's going to allow them to get promotion kind of easy, well, so long as they qualify. It is going to give them other incentives and so on. I think they would go along with that. In the terms of the persons with disabilities and so on, you can have to have built into the schools the kind of physical structures and so on that will think. So the government and the nation will have to get funding sometimes. Well, we do it already. We go to the World Bank and so on, and we can say we want to justify. We went to the World Bank for money to schools, for example, and I think we had to say that they had to be co-ed schools. We haven't even mentioned that, by the way. So when we look to get funding for them, we can say we need funding because we want to pay special attention to our students with disabilities and so on. We want to show that we are going to be climate resilient in our schools, etc., etc. And all of that, really, I'm glad that you brought that in, because that is part of education reform. Education reform is not just putting a school in the middle of the city and just leaving it there, because a school in the city, I'm glad you bring these things in, the school in the city should be an oasis.
Yes.
that is what it should be. So when you go to St. Mary's, and when you go to Wesley Hall, I believe in the earlier days Wesley Hall was an oasis. Right now Wesley Hall is rather rundown. And therefore, in order to give that upliftment, you have to do those things, but catering for the needs of the people in that, so that the students would be proud to go to that school, even if they come from what you might call the lower echelons of society. When they leave schools one morning, they're leaving proudly, going to Wesley Hall, going to St. Mary's, going to St. Albans, going to St. Clement's, because those are schools in the past that were extremely productive in what they were doing in those days. In the modern day, they falter because things have changed, the world have gone past us, really, and we need to bring our education into the modern world.
Okay, thank you for that answer, Mr. Adams. Always insightful. It's 11 o'clock in Barbados and across the Eastern Caribbean. We go to another commercial break.
Please note the following changes to our programming of Let's Talk About It on Quality 100.7 FM. On Monday, September the 9th, the Reverend Senator Charles Morris returns to the chair to discuss the issues of the day. Let's Talk About It, the Elder Affair Edition with Patrick Eswick and George Griffith, will be presented on Wednesday, September the 11th. Q100.7 FM, the heart of the community.
That's the sound of your animals. Strong, healthy, and delivering yields you love.
That didn't just happen. It began with you feeding them only the best. East Caribbean Feeds. Rest assured, we only produce your feeds with premium ingredients. No hormones, no animal byproducts. Just everything your animal needs for maximum nutrition. Because your animals deserve only the best. East Caribbean Feeds for maximum nutrition.
ECGC Feeds are still here with better prices than before. With island-wide delivery available at Walk Springs Group, Inc., St. Thomas. Obliss Variety, Inc., Marchfield, 6 Roads, St. Phillips. Feed Shed Constitution, Van Stand. Telephone numbers 826-2168, 537-0089, and 851-1160.
Follow me to Q in the Community this Thursday. Q in the Community is sponsored by Banks Beer, Deputy, Guinness, Guinness Smooth, Dasani Water, Minute Maid Juice, Smirnoff Ice, Smirnoff Vodka, Johnny Walker, Black and White Whiskey, Barefoot Wines, Rida Hard Wines, Pepsi, Juicy, 7-Up, White Rock Ginger Ale, White Rock Soda Water, Angostura White Oak Rum, and Fernandez Black Label Rum.
MCTV just scored a massive goal! The English Premier League is back on MCTV's ESPN. So, round up your team and catch every thrilling moment of EPL action live on ESPN. MCTV just won the game!
We're back. It's 3 minutes past 11 here in Barbados and across the Eastern Caribbean. This is Let's Talk About It on Q100.7 FM. And before we return to our phone lines, I'll just read a WhatsApp message from one of Barbados's poet laureates, Barbados's first poet laureate, Esther Phillips. She says, Mr. Adams's input regarding educational reform is extremely important. We need this quality of knowledge and honest analysis. The common entrance examination should have been abolished long ago. There is too much failure, especially among our young men, and it's primarily the present educational system that has failed them.
Wow.
And I believe this message it asks, begs that question about single-sex schools and co-ed schools, Mr. Adams.
Oh, dear. Some people might put me on a hobby horse, but not really, because people kind of misunderstood my point. Now, it is interesting that in that great contribution from Esther Phillips, that she mentioned the failure rate. Mm. And that you focus on the boys, because we cannot, like the ostrich, you know, put our heads in the sand and pretend that because we have co-ed education and because we have the 11 plus that there's this great equality in education. Now, in one of our most influential research documents, which is the white paper, I think that was 1995, thereabouts. Minister Motley was education minister and did some work in trying to reform the system then, and did not fully succeed, but made some inroads. In that document, you found that in 1994, there were 412 students that got marks between 0 and 19. Of those students, 309 were boys, 3/4, and 103 were girls. In 1995, it got even worse. There were 535 students who got marks between 0 and 19 after all these years in primary school, and 482 of them were boys. Mm-hmm. And 53 were girls. Those are 2 years, but those are not aberrations. those are things that were happening way back. In fact, last week I mentioned Douglas Lynch, who was one of our foremost businessmen, and he was so appalled in the 1980s, around 1984, I think it was, that he took statistics from the Ministry of Education to show that 4 out of 10 boys in Barbados in the 1980s had great difficulty in maths and English and so on. It is telling us that the system that we have, the 11 plus and so on, people tend to feel that this can be solved without that, have led to the neglect of our boys in the primary school. And there are several reasons for that. And I believe one of the first points about that is that in our teacher training, I strongly believe this, that we have not fully taken into consideration the fact that boys and girls are different and that they're mature at different rates. The Barbados public should come to understand that girls by 11 are 2 years or sometimes more matured physically than a boy. And that is a serious thing because they're in the same class, and it means that very often the girls are dominating the class, and psychologically that comes to be an impact. But the psychological point is important at that level and other levels too, because the makeup of boys when they are with girls does not allow them to overcome being belittled in front of girls, and so it pushes them into the background. This is what the research is saying. This is also happening in the cognitive sphere, apart from the physical one that I just mentioned. In the cognitive sphere, the girls have the genetic facility to acquire language at a faster rate and a better level than boys do. And this is particularly true in the primary, at the primary level. So that the teachers who are teaching boys and girls together must be, it is essential, crucial, that the teacher is aware of that. Because if the teacher is not aware of that, the difference between the two will widen as they go through the primary school. And the research also shows that by the time the boy gets to 11 years old, most girls are 2 years ahead of him linguistically. This will not happen to every single boy, but this is general. It is so general that the Barbadian public ought to know that with this 11 plus phenomenon that we have, that the girls are treated differently in terms of marks and placement than the boys because of this very reason. The average range of marks at the higher level will be dominated by the girls. And so a boy, in order to get a boy in a secondary school, you normally have to fiddled with the marks in order for that to happen. And therefore the concept of gender and co-ed is extremely important, particularly in the system that we have with the 11 plus, because it forces the teachers to concentrate on the girls who are naturally quicker than the boys, so that in some schools, and this is also in coming down to Barbados now, because what I was speaking about is generally in the industrial world and so on. But in Barbados, you will find that in many schools, the 11 plus class, as they call it, are dominated by girls. And when you get down to 1A5 or whatever it is, it is dominated by boys. And I remember, you might say this is anecdotal, but it is actually factual, that in discussing a boy's performance, this time at a secondary school, the teacher said to the parent, don't feel badly because this child has come four things out of 30 or 32, because he is first among the boys. Mm. Now you see how this thing goes percolates throughout the educational system, and it is creating a kind of male, Barbadian male, that is lacking in self-confidence and self-esteem. And if we are to maintain the co-ed system, it has to be taken into consideration. There's also no compelling reason why all the schools should be co-ed. But given the fact that, you know, they are co-ed, these considerations must be taken into consideration, particularly. And you can tell, for example, if we have one of our boys who are excelling in some area, and you put a mic in front of him, what is happening? The opposite. You have a young lady now, a girl, and she is more eloquent. And all of that is happening as a result of the school. Because I was making the point that people don't understand that the school compensates for the shortcomings. Barbados was a country that traditionally had single-sex schools. History is very important. Persons your age and so on may not know that Bishop Coleridge, in building the churches, he was the prolific church builder in Barbados, and wherever he built a church, he also mandated that there be two schools, one for girls and one for boys. And as you go through Barbados, you find St. Albans boys and St. Albans girls, St. Silas boys and St. Silas girls, and All Saints boys and All Saints girls, and so on and so on. And what the record shows too was that it was the boys' school who were basically taught by all men. The boys' schools were the outstanding schools. Right through Barbados until the 11 plus came into Barbados. The boys' schools, when you hear about the boys' schools, St. Giles, Wesley Hall, St. Clements, All Saints, where Owen Arthur and those persons come from. And we could go on and on and on, almost wherever you go, you would find the Bay Street Boys School and so on. And those boys excel not only in Barbados, but across the Caribbean. And therefore, our boys need to have what I would call some level of positive discrimination in our co-ed schools in order to close the gap and get some parity of esteem.
Okay, gentlemen, we take another commercial break and we'll return in just a moment.
This summer, QFM takes you through summer like no other. Celebrate summer on Q as we help you burn off those calories. Tune your waistlines with our rhythmic summer collection of music all day and all night long.
The 2024 BCA Supercup 50 over final between ESAFU Pickwick and Challengers Wildey is on this Sunday, September 8th. There will be boundaries galore and stumps flying at the Windward Cricket Club in Lucas Street, St. Philip, from 9:45 a.m. Follow this exciting action on www.barbadoscricket.org.bb and also join us on CBC TV 8 from 2:30 p.m. It's cricket, lovely cricket, on CBC TV 8, the home of championships.
We got it all at Nichols. We got it all at Nichols. We got it all at Nichols. We got it all at Nichols Bakery.
For always fresh.
It's 17 minutes past 11 here in Barbados and across the Eastern Caribbean. This is Let's Talk About It on Q100.7 FM. We go up until 11:30 this morning, so we return to our phone lines. Good morning. Let's talk about it. Good morning, caller.
Hello, good morning.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning.
Hey. Hello, gentlemen.
Hey, good morning.
Now, I want to make 3 points.
Go right ahead.
I feel somehow that one of the great tragedies of the development of education in Barbados is, I would say, how the political class of the 50s and so on saw it. Now, I recall as a small boy going to political, from then was in primary school, going to political meetings. And all the politicians were telling black people, and it was, they wanted them to go to, say, the law school. And of course, in their view, they saw whatever white people had, black people, they wanted for black people. Nothing wrong with that. But to me, that was a very short-sighted view. And I think it persists up to today. Because, for example,
Go ahead.
Yeah. No, what I'm saying is that they told people, oh, well, you want to get this school. But they didn't seem to have any plan for... they didn't see education as important for national development and to talk about building excellent schools for our people. See my point? But I thought that was a major shortcoming of education of that era. And I think it persists to this day.
Okay.
Now, the second point I want to make is this. I would like to see a system of education where we can determine the most outstanding school. Now, I would even suggest that maybe a business house could do it. Award a good prize to the most outstanding school every year. I would love to see that. But how can we do it now? How can we do it in a system where you allocate your top students to maybe 4 schools, and then you dump the ones who get the lowest marks at certain schools? And then, of course, the society is brainwashed to see the 4 schools are the best schools in the island. And what idiocy, even from so-called intelligent people. I think that will go a long way.
Yes.
To improving the performance. And not only that, but I wonder sometimes, how can you, if you're doing performance appraisal of teachers, how can you appraise the performance of a teacher at St. Lucie and at Harrison College? And all the merchants are transferred through the system. That puzzles me a bit. How what kind of performance appraisal system they have to regulate?
Carla, you've made some significant points. You went back to the 50s, early 60s and so on, when the notion was that Barbadian parents wanted their children as well to get into those schools, the large Harrison College, Combermere, and so on. And one could understand that. In fact, for a long time, they were the only schools in Barbados. I think what the caller is saying is that when the other schools were built to give access to the masses, that they were deliberately built not to promote excellence, but not to be able to compete with the existing schools. And I think that a mistake was made there. I commented on that before, and the reason for that was that our elite schools, our older secondary schools, had the headmasters from England, and quite a few of them had the majority of their teachers also imported from England. And they had a mindset about the masses in Barbados. And even earlier, when the schools were set up in the first place, Barbadians, I think I mentioned this, but I need to mention it again, that Bishop Mitchinson was bullied by the elite planter class not to have their children sitting in the same school as the lower white people in Barbados. And that gave us the first grade grammar schools and the second grade grammar schools. And then when the schools were extended education, the newer secondary schools came now down below there. So you virtually had not only a dual system, but you have a tripartite system with those at the bottom. So I think that was a very good point, and it was a mistake, because it is at that period that Barbados should have done what other countries in the world were doing and not follow the British. The other countries in the world went comprehensive. And I mentioned them by name, nobody can dispute that. But we maintained the system that we have. The second point that he was speaking about praises for our schools of excellence is a pretty good idea, but what we want to promote, certainly through this program and through education reform, that we should have, I don't want to put the school excellent in the mix, but we should have good quality schools across Barbados. And in some cases, as he was mentioning, and the caller was mentioning, the private sector could get involved as well, because they are going to benefit from the output of the school. And I remember I mentioned the story, I think I ought to mention it very quickly, going to Nova Scotia. And when they were going to build a new school there, the private sector came in with the public sector and built and financed a new school, heavily geared towards the needs of the Nova Scotian community at the time. And something like that can happen in Barbados, where the private sector must begin to see that they too have an interest. It is in their enlightened self-interest, really, to ensure that we are having good schools all across Barbados, so that when they are looking for entrance into their businesses, yeah, their workforce, that they will virtually know that they are having people coming in of a certain quality. So those are two very good points that were made by the caller. Well,
yes, and we thank him for that valuable contribution. We go on to our next caller, possibly final caller for this morning's program. Good morning, let's talk about it.
Good morning.
Yes,
good morning,
sir. Go right ahead. We have 3 minutes remaining. Go right ahead.
Okay. I just want to thank Mr. Adams for the work he's doing.
Yes, sir.
I want to ask him a very important question. The definition of education is a very important definition, for the simple reason, if we don't understand what education is, then we will be wasting a lot of our time. And I don't know if you would have heard of her, a lady by the name of Ellen White.
Yes.
In her book, Education, she gives a definition.
From the Adventists.
And that's right.
Get on. Yes.
And the definition of education, she says, it's more than the mere pursuit of a certain set of studies. It is the harmonious development of all the faculties, the physical, the mental, and the spiritual.
Yes.
And if we understand those things, then we will be on our way to be able to change, to make adjustments to the education system.
Yes, sir.
Which is long overdue.
Yes, sir.
I totally agree with you. There's a good point. I want to finish very quickly by trying to say to the Barbados public why we must reform our education system. It might appear to be negative, but this is what I believe, some notes that I made, I believe will happen if we do not change. We will have a reduction in our standard of living. We will have an inability to compete in the fast-paced, high-tech world of today. The Barbadian worker will be stuck at unskilled and semi-skilled level and deemed to be uncompetitive in the world of work. The result will be an economy which is incapable of producing high-end goods and services like Singapore and so on. Barbadian goods and services will be uncompetitive, particularly in price and quality. Exports earnings are likely to drop and leading to balance of payments problems and the reliance of Barbados on other countries to supply our goods and services. We will have persistently low growth rates and we will be unable to earn our way in the world. Mm-hmm. And we will have economic decline and social dislocation, which is threatening us mm-hmm. at the moment. I thought I would try to end there. It may appear to be negative, but it is really positive.
Yes.
And show why we must not allow the reform to falter. I mean, we are faltering now, but we should not let the reform movement fail.
Yes.
That this is the time that we should take it by the horns.
Indeed.
And involve the whole country into a mission where at the end of the day, everybody will be a winner in terms of education reform.
Yes, sir, Mr. Adams, we thank you so very much. It has indeed been a pleasure to sit at your feet and learn a lot about our education system past and what can be going forward. You
yes.
are indeed a revered researcher, an acclaimed author, and an erudite educator. We thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I am very
yes, sir.
Elated.
Yes, sir. I'm Joshua Hinkson. I was joined by my co-host, Rashid Best. Special thanks to our producers, Sherwood McCaskey and Andre Herewood, and technical operator, Michael Sobers. Good morning.